Feeling squeamish is a basic and important emotion. There are some things that turn almost everyone's tummies. Maggots, dog poo,
dried sick on a pavement, a bogey smeared on the edge of a sink.
But did you know that this is something that you learn and it develops as you get older? Babies, for example, aren't squeamish at all.
Well, to put this idea to the test, we're going to need a baby. Give me one moment, Chris. Here you go, Chris. One baby.
Xand, this is my baby. This is Lyra, your niece.
Whatever. And we're going to need some of the most disgusting things we can think of. First up, worms. Here you go, here's some yummy worms. What do you think of that?
Look at that.
This is not a baby that's disgusted by a worm, is it?
Fair enough. Next up, maggots.
What do you think of that? Really disgusting. Look at them move.
She's got one in her hand.
I mean, that is not a disgusted baby, is it?
Right. If worms and maggots don't make you feel squeamish, Lyra, I'm going to pull out all the stops with this next thing.
Let's see if Lyra is disgusted by Rose. What do you think of Rose?
Lyra seems very, very unbothered by Rose, and she's not bothered by the most disgusting thing of all, Dr. Xand's beard and bogeys.
Not disgusted by anything.
No, he's not Dada, I'm Dada.
They're here!
Come on, let's get them. Petra! What a massive treat to see you. Welcome to the Ouch Lab. Now, Petra is a kind of slug called Veronicella sloanii, or a pancake slug. And we've brought them here today to discuss all the things we have in common.
I don't think I've got anything in common with a slug.
Well, actually, Chris, you do. In your cells, in Petra's cells, in my cells, in your cells, in fact, in the cells of every living thing on Earth is a molecule called DNA.
DNA stands for deoxyribonucleic acid, and it's a very long, thin molecule made of two strands, a bit like a very long ladder, but the strands have been twisted into a shape called a double helix, a little bit like this ice lolly.
No eating in the lab! Give me that, I'm confiscating it. Chris, you know the rules.
Well, DNA makes up the genetic code, the instruction manual inside almost every cell in your body. It's what makes humans humans and slugs slugs.
And it all fits into the teeny tiny nucleus in the middle of your body's cells.
And despite the obvious differences, we all share 70% of our DNA with Petra.
Wow!
Now, 70% might sound like a lot, but what's even more amazing is that we share 99.9% of our DNA with you.
The point is, when it comes to DNA, tiny percentages can make a huge difference. And your DNA is unique. No other human on the planet will have the same DNA as you.
That's right, or you, Petra. How are you getting along with my special guests, Andy? To be honest, Chris, when you said I was about to meet one of the most dangerous sea creatures on Earth, I was prepared to meet a killer whale. All I can see is a small shrimp-like crustacean.
That is Herman the mantis shrimp.
Hello!
Tucked up under his chin, he's got two special clubs. He can punch faster than you can blink, and in fact, he punches so fast that he produces something called cavitation bubbles under the sea, and when these bubbles collapse, they generate temperatures that are hotter than the surface of the sun.
Like to see a killer whale do any of that!
Yes, this shrimp is amazing. And you know what? We all have something in common with Herman, because his clubs are made from the same type of super strong substance that make up your bones and teeth. Crystals.
Now, this is a model of a crystal. And crystals form when tiny particles arrange themselves in repeating patterns. Now, each one of these balls represents an atom. And atoms are tiny building blocks that make up just about everything, including you. And as the atoms arrange themselves in a repeating pattern, crystals form. This is a model of table salt. So sometimes when you look at table salt, you can see its tiny crystals.
In nature, crystals grow in all sorts of places, in the sea, in caves, in rocks underground.
Your body is amazing at making crystals too. They help to form your bones and your teeth.
Crystals are so good at growing that sometimes they can grow in places you don't want them to grow, like the bladder or the kidneys.
And you don't want sharp crystals poking about in soft, squishy places in your body where they shouldn't be.
You know, Tinchy, ever since you walked into this lab, I was thinking, there's something familiar about this lizard. And then I got it. We've got the same great aunt Dolores. When I say great, I mean she's our great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-aunt Dolores. So that makes us cousins 50 million times removed.
Xand, what's going on?
I'm just having a bit of a gossip with Cousin Tinchy here. Aren't you going to say hello?
Hello, Tinchy.
Hello, Chris. Skin.
Now, it's amazing to think that we really are all related to lizards. Tinchy's your cousin too, and it's all thanks to evolution.
Evolution is the process by which all living things change over time to adapt to their environment. So although Tinchy and Xand may look quite different, they share lots of similarities, from the number of fingers on their hands to their salivary glands. Of course, they have differences too. One of them just lies around in the sun all day eating insects, and the other one is a lizard. It's the similarities between us and other animals that first allowed scientists to figure out that we evolved from common ancestors. One of the things that you share with Cousin Tinchy here are the bones in your ear, the ossicles.
George, what I brought you here for is your expertise on jumping, so I can get hold of Dr. Chris's secret crisis chocky bar.
Did somebody say something about my secret emergency chocolate bar?
No, we didn't say anything about that at all, Chris. I was merely discussing things with George. Have you met? He's a frog.
Of course I've met him. Hi, George. George is a White's tree frog, and he's been helping me with my tendon research. Now, frogs like George are expert at jumping. And he starts with his legs folded up like this.
But if we look at him jump, his muscles contract, which pull on the tendons, moving the bones in his legs.
This is a tendon masterclass. In the Animal Olympics, frogs would be the world leaders. Magnificent performance, Helga. Look, we're going to try it one more time. 5, 6, 7, 8.
Is that a cockatiel?
Yes, this is Helga. She's the soloist for the new Operation Ouch theme tune. Birds are amazing singers because they have two voice boxes, but you only have one.
Only one?
There's no need to be too smug, Helga. Humans can, in fact, make noises without using our voice boxes at all.
Show off.
You can have a go at this too. First, place your hand on the front of your neck and try singing a low note.
La.
You'll feel vibrations coming from your vocal cords. Now keep your hand where it is and try whistling.
I can't feel any vibrations at all.
Exactly, and that's because your vocal cords have nothing to do with being able to make those sounds.
Smarty pants. So how do you whistle?
Good question, Helga. The sound of your normal voice is created when air vibrates the vocal cords or folds in your larynx.
When you whistle, you need to create a space for air to be pushed through. You usually do this by making a small O-shaped hole with your lips. Your tongue then takes air coming out of your lungs, focuses it so there's a constant pressure, and then directs it to the hole in your lips. Then, by gently blowing air out through the hole, you can make a whistling sound. So your vocal folds, or cords as most people call them, aren't used at all when you whistle.